or not. Let's have it on. Why did I close Sinset? Here we go. Activate. Sit on Facepalm. Need it on Facepalm. We also need it on Twitch. Let's check if it's on Twitch already. Yes, it's on Twitch. That's good. Why is it not working on Sinset?
Don't look at us.
Am I missing a live? But because this, they change things a bit here. No source connected.
Well, hopefully it's changed for the better, but...
Oh, it looks a lot better. It just doesn't seem to be working right now. Not taking the feed. Oh, maybe I need to click the live. Okay, let's see if that worked. And then republishers, if that one is working. Do I need to turn it off and on again? Let's give it a couple of seconds. Hey, Matatronic, how you doing, man? Welcome to the stream. Also, Bitten, I seen you around. Welcome to the stream, man. Actually, Bitten is woman, not man. Sorry, my bad. Need to be more careful with that. Why isn't the stream working? Okay, let's try stopping, deactivating, reactivating. What about now? Work now. Hey, Yobe, how's it going? Hey, Evil, welcome.
Yes, Yobe, I am all elite, of course.
Where is our chat? I don't see it. Oh, is it here?
It's on Twitch.
No. Twitch is doing the chat.
Okay, so I have to open another window.
Okay, so it seems that Sinset is working, but the video not found, that's not working. That's the opposite of working.
It was like winning, except we didn't win, and then we lost.
Hey, Lala. Hey, Random. Welcome, guys.
I have absolutely no idea what that thing that I just said is from at all. Way too much freaking time.
I was supposed to be live on Sinset. I don't know why it's not working. You try turning it off and on again. The video was not found. So we're watching Silly Venture releases while we try to figure out why the hell the Sinset stream is not working. Maybe they changed something on their side. Maybe they changed something on this side. What?
Did you try reinstalling Firefox?
No. Because Firefox has nothing to do with it.
Because, you know, that solved another problem we had earlier.
Yeah, that is true. We have multiple servers on Sinset. We have Sinset regular, we have Sinset low latency, we have Twitch channel, we have Twitch video, we have Twitch collection, we have YouTube. I think I want Sinset regular, which was the one that was already set up. I don't understand why it's not working. Aspect ratio is 16:9, which I have no clue if it's correct or not, but I'm gonna assume it is. And it is active, so it should be working. Why isn't it working? Work, goddammit. Video not found. But I am streaming to my own server, which should be streaming to them. No, I'm not. I'm streaming to Restream because I'm stupid. That's why. Okay, so guys, I'm gonna turn this off and I'm gonna...
Okay.
fix stuff and come back.
Which channel are we in? Are we in MST 9K or PS Enough?
We are in PS Enough. On Twitch, it's PS Enough, yeah. Okay, be right back.
The channel. But I don't seem to see any activity in the Twitch chat on IRC, so it's not PS underscore enough, I take it.
No.
It's just all together. Yeah. It's Twitch TV handle. Let me just copy paste that for you.
No, that's okay.
Too late already. I already got it. I'm throwing it in Telegram.
We should be streaming again, I hope.
Yep. Confirmed, I have it.
Okay. Let's see if it's on CSAT.
Yeah, there's evil saying something, so there we go. Okay, good.
Okay, we see some bandwidth usage, so I guess that's positive. Will it show up on Facebook? That's the real question. Actually, let's test if it's really on CNSAT first. I play.
We should probably mention to people that we'll also have a show next Wednesday.
Yes, we will. I will do that. I will do that. What a fix to republishing. Stop it. Replay it. It work. Republishing to Facebook activated. Come on, show up on Facebook.
Or don't, because we don't.
It's a bit ridiculous, but a lot of people only get notifications because they saw it on Facebook, so it's stupid. Used to work.
I look at it this way. If they're only interested in Facebook and not interested in the scene in general, are we really losing anything?
No, because they are in the demo scene group at Facebook.
Yeah. I have no problems, you know, announcing it there, but, you know, the whole, I will only use services that are on Facebook.
It's not the only service I use, obviously.
Yeah, no. I'm not talking about you. You're using multiple things, and eventually, when we get the I wrote to Gasman a little while ago about trying to, because there's some interest in making a federated demo scene video instance.
That would be interesting.
Yeah, I figured you would be. I mean, because you could also have a federated one for Enough Records.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but I haven't spent the time to set it up yet. I will have the last week of this year off, so there's a bunch of stuff I'm going to be doing that week with servers. Which, if anybody here from Titan is going, oh shit, I thought we were doing something else. That's going to happen too. I just don't know. I have 1 week to get a whole hell of a lot of shit done, but at least I have the week off.
Hey, Vigo, welcome to the stream, man. Trying to get this working on YouTube. I'm about to give up on Facebook. I'm happy with everything else.
The other thing is we need to figure out some way that we can get the Facebook chat over to the Twitch chat, over to the other chats. I mean, it's just...
Yeah, Facebook chat is a bitch to get.
Yeah.
Twitch is okay. You can sort of get it, I think.
Oh, you can totally. I'm on with IRC. I can show you how to do that.
Yeah. So that's not so hard.
And you can, if you can get on there with IRC, you can. That's how most of the people are using it to feed the live chat thing on their streams on Twitch. They have a bot that connects there, and then it gets data.
Yeah, at some point I wanted to do like a bot for Discord that would like catch whoever is live streaming on Twitch that does anything remotely related to a demo scene, either a demo party or someone coding shaders or demo scene musicians, and just have that automated, like have a schedule for what's coming up next, and at the same time do like announcements and stuff like that. But I think people, cool. Well, it's an okay idea, but people would have to actually go there and register and update the information and stuff like that. And that's the part where these kind of things usually fail.
Yeah, and the fact that it's Tencent as well, so.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to give up on Facebook. We are live on SceneSat and YouTube and Twitch. Should be enough for everyone.
That's enough.
So made it like have a schedule for what's coming up next. Yeah, so I'm going to announce this. And we have 10 minutes left. I'm still watching Steel Adventure demos. If anyone wants to request anything, you have 10 whole minutes to request something. And after that, we will be covering stuff from Nova, from Evoke, from other parties in August, other parties in September, and then probably we're going to leave October and November and December for a second show that's going to be airing next week at the same day, in same Wednesday, same time. So, yeah. Matatronic wants to see the Vortex Wild demos. Well, which one? I know which one you want to see. I'm going to play that
now. We'll play that. Yeah, play that one now, and then we'll go over it next week.
This is the best WoW demo ever, and very chat
very,
appropriate.
Very appropriate for the channel. Yes.
Yeah.
Because this would not exist if it weren't for Mystery Science Theater 9000.
Hey, don't talk over the demo truck.
I'm talking over the demo. Actually, the thing is that this isn't completely a movie player because it's got other augmentations. This is actually doing more than most of the bad Apple.
So they heard the feedback and they applied it.
Oh yeah. No, that's why you do say things like
putting another bad Apple animation to an actual combo, or putting it up and saying, "Oh, hey, this is my demo." It's not the same thing. It's a movie player of somebody else.
I wish they had done a better job with the tracking, though. Like some proper technology.
Well, that's it. Yeah, he was doing this mostly mobile, and he also was doing it in.
That's it.
Espresso House in Helsinki, which then apparently refunded him two of his coffees that he had that day. And we can't figure out why.
But I'm not okay with bad apples.
I like the part about PS being wrong.
Bad Apple demos are not real demos. They're just video players. Video players in old school platforms.
Sorry. On old school platforms, everything is cool.
Yes, I'm right.
Okay, let's stuff from Vortex that we have to see because it's awesome. Well, there were more awesome stuff from Vortex, but unfortunately we're getting close to the start of the show. We're gonna be watching the rest of this properly next week and commenting on it properly next week. Well, did you actually... well, you did go to Vortex Truck, so can you tell us a little bit about Vortex before we start the show?
It was a party. It was in November. It was in Tampere, and we can talk about it next week!
Okay, so let's not talk of anything during 5 minutes.
Are we 5 minutes before the actual show starts, or are we...
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Yeah, alright. Well, I mean, I don't want to make it so that we're repeating the same thing next week.
Let's talk about something in the past. How was your assembly?
I do need to check with Rimina and find out what the status is on us using that huge screen. We need to be able to do that.
For our demos? Yeah.
Yes. Pehu was saying that he wanted that, and generally that would indicate that, yeah, it will happen. But do need to find out for sure what's up. And also, because it is a extremely huge resolution, we need to find out how we can do that before it becomes, you know, hey, how do we do this? Oh, gosh, I have no idea how we do it. Well, we only have 1 month. I guess we're not going to have a production. So, yeah, finding out now would be good for people to get started on things, because I forget what the resolution was, but it was something like...
3 times the normal screen?
Vertically, it's... I think it's just slightly larger than 4K. But horizontally, it's like five times. It's like seven screens wide or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's just huge.
Real size. Yeah, I remember seeing it, and it's we definitely need to try some productions there. Bombay is saying on the chat that you should be a little bit louder if you can increase your volume somehow.
I don't know if I can. I can increase the volume on the... I'm not using a mixer, so...
I need subtitles for this demo, by the way. It's like MetalVox's winner demo, but made
exactly,
by Jumalauta people about Amiga.
It's not by Jumalauta people. but yeah, just apply winner demo to it. This is the finished version of winner demo.
Yeah. And we took so long to get proper subtitles for winner demo that I really want to expedite that process. So if anyone out there wants to translate this piece of art, I'm sure... A lot of us people who don't speak Finnish would appreciate.
Of course, yeah. I realized I never needed subtitles for winner demo. It's like, oh,
you
yeah,
lucky bastard.
Like, yep, sorry, 4 languages and counting.
This is an Amiga. We will be showing some dicks later.
No problem.
I'm not really sure why you need to translate it.
Hey Gaspard, welcome to the show!
That's not the right one. Let's try this.
Greetings!
Alright, this
I love
is
the
as
cursor
loud
here.
As I can get the microphone to go.
Okay. And this is the important scene. They took a lot of months making this perfect.
Oh, that was a perfect loop.
Yeah.
If you're watching this at work, good luck.
Yeah.
Not safe for work.
I mean, you know, given that it's obviously, you know, supposed to be
It's art. Yes.
Well, low art. It's, you know, got a lot of time.
How low can you go?
But yeah, this is... This is not going to win any awards for being innovative.
I'm going to submit this for Meteorics in Best Design if they have one.
You know, honestly, I can make a case for good design.
It's just because it has the Amiga logo.
No, not because of that, but because of the fact that it's, you know, if you remove all of the content that somebody might actually find offensive, being the Amiga stuff and the dicks.
Amiga stuff is always offensive. That's true.
Well, to some people, yes. those of us that are enlightened, no. But, you know, if you actually remove that, it's actually a fairly well put together thing. I'm not sure it is of the
same level.
If this is the best that we've got as far as design for this year, but then we also need
level C instead.
Well, no, but and you don't have. I need to get the copy of Nobi had a fantastic thing at DemoBit where he made a case for design and the demo scene, and that we haven't defined it, that it may not be definable, mm-hmm. and we continue to say, oh, I like the design of that, and then somebody else will say, oh, the design in that is just useless. And exactly
well,
what
design
does
depends-
design mean?
Yeah, it depends on the definition of what are you designing for.
So he put out a lot of things in this presentation, and it really should be read mm-hmm. by everybody, or probably turned into a demo. I would hope that it could
be done
like
that
way.
Is that like a seminar presentation kind
yes,
of thing?
Yes, it was a seminar thing.
And, so it should be online somewhere, right?
No, I don't think it is.
Oh, that's sad.
Because I'm not sure. Yeah, that's the thing, is it... I'm not really sure, because
I'm Googling for it, see if I can find it or not.
I don't think that was recorded.
I don't think it was recorded. That's the thing.
No.
I have the text, and he really, I don't want to publish it for him because I think it should be something that he presents as his own material. Mm-hmm. But I think it, as I said to him, I think it was the most important. Presentation we've had on
design and
demo
scene.
On demo scene content, because it doesn't just go into design, it also goes a lot into when you're explaining what the demo scene is to people.
Mm-hmm.
If you can't explain design, how do you explain what the demo scene is? Because there's so much design that goes into it. And it really was a very... I have it somewhere, but I don't have it within arm's reach. So I will try to have it for next week, but I also will try to get a hold of Nobi. I almost think that, you know, if he doesn't turn it into a production, which I can also see where EOS would not turn it into a production because it wouldn't fit in 4K.
Well, they tried to do more stuff, not just 4K and 8K.
No, I know, but I mean, EOS would... You know, AOS, 8K, whatever. But this is more along the lines of, okay, it's a different type of thing. Maybe they could do it, but maybe that isn't the way to do it for this type of production.
Let's give him a week and let's say, okay, guys, we want to talk this, but we want to present this. How you want it brought? We can say, well, we have the text. Take it from there.
No Signal Input is saying on the chat that there's actually a full stream from DemoBit days. Was it like on stage that he gave this presentation or just...
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah. I mean, might be captured. We just need to crop it.
Well, it depends. Which things are in that stream? And is it from this past year? Because there's been more than one demo.
Yeah, from this year. Please, No Signal Input says.
Because we don't remember seeing any cameras and we were there.
might just be the webcam that was live streaming all the time. So.
It also very well could be in the SceneSat archives, because we did stream SceneSat.
Okay, homework, people. If you want to dig this up, it would be great to have it.
Yes.
So we can have some material for discussion. Anyways, it is 7 o'clock, at least in Lisbon. So time to get this show started. Welcome, everyone, to Mystery Demo Scene Theater 9000. We've been away for a little while. This is season 4, episode 9. We're almost at the end of the year. I was a father for a couple of months. It's been a pretty hectic. So
let me correct you. You're still a father.
I'm still a father, but the momentum of happening, the child appearing into the world, happened on these past months. And so things have been a little hectic around the house here. But we're starting to get things in gear again and have some residual free time to do some live streams. So I hope to be able to do some Mystery Demo Scene Theaters again. And we started off this show trying to round up some of the releases that we didn't manage to cover throughout the remaining summer and autumn of 2019. I have the Arrogant Busters with me, Frankie and Truck. Thank you guys for joining.
Hello.
We were mentioning that we might not have enough time on this show to go over everything that was left from 2019. So we will do another show next week, the December 18th, with whatever is left of 2019 worth checking out. And maybe just a roundup of the year as well. I don't know. We don't know. We'll figure it out. But we'll have another show next week. So note down on your notebooks. Anyways, to start things off, we're going to take a look at stuff from Nova. I wanted to do a special episodes only on Nova, but some of the BitShifters guys were not completely online. They were coming on holidays and stuff. We ended up not being able to show that, so I wanted to show the demos now. We have a lot of cool stuff. This one is for the Acorn. It's called Wave Runner for the BBC Master. Or it's called BBC Master Demo. Wave Runner,
yeah,
BBC Master.
BBC Master is also an Acorn, so it's
okay. That explains things.
Yes.
So what's the difference between this and an old Acorn? Because the Acorn I know is only like black and green, and this has colors.
The thing is that basically the BBC series was also made by Acorn for the BBC, so there's a huge overlap, but where your car must have the steering wheel on the wrong side in order to understand it.
Hmm.
So only those who drive on the wrong side of the road know how it works.
So some Australians a few decades ago also knew,
yes,
but now
exactly. Japan looking at you.
Now it's becoming a lost art.
So no, in general, the and I think the BBC Master was one of the models, because you have the BBC Micro, you had multiple models in that as well, with different memory and whatever.
And color specs and stuff like
I'm
that.
I'm pretty sure somebody who is from the British Isles will now scream at us in the chat for getting it all wrong.
Yeah, like when I said that the Amstrad was a French machine.
Oh, yes.
Oops.
Well, let's face it. The French are the ones that are actually doing... The French and the Spanish are the ones that are actually doing something with it. The British never did.
No, because it never was... It was a British thing which went completely tits up, and then the French distributor bought everything and sold it at a huge discount. So that's where your market is.
So, bottom line is, it may as well be a French machine.
For all of this, yes. If I look at in my website, where do I sell things for Amstrad? It's in France.
Yep.
So where the biggest market ended up being, yeah.
Yep.
Anyways, Nova seems to have a lot of guys that are a lot interested in these old British machines, curiously enough, because it's pretty much the only British demo party so far. I heard there were some wicked rumors that Ireland's also going to have a demo party. I don't know if Mentatronic has any news on that. I see him laughing on the chat, so I'm wondering.
I know that it actually is going to happen because Dad popped up in the chat on Telegram, and he confirmed it, and I know that Mentatronic has confirmed it. And I think I might even be able to pronounce it as Craig Party.
Is it Craig or Craig?
It is. Oh, I'm sorry. It's neither. It's crack party.
Oh, it's the crack. Let's have some crack at this party.
Well, no, because it's spelled differently. But yeah, I asked and I was then corrected that it is actually crack party. That's right, Manitronic, right? Yes, there.
The Bitten is talking about an Amiga.
Have a date.
It's on the crack party website. I'm not sure it has a date yet.
They just missed a location, but that never stopped anyone from booking tickets to attend the party, right, Truck?
Nope, it certainly has never stopped anybody. That's why Tomb has a full roster this year, and why nobody went to Inertia.
Anyways, the demo that we're watching right now is the Master of Orion. I think the demo is called the Master. The group is called Horizon, and it's for the Archimedes 3000. Whatever the fuck is an Archimedes 3000? Anyone knows? Because I don't.
It's something British.
Something British for sure. It has some graphics on it, some 32-bit graphics apparently, or 16-bit. I'm not. Oh, it says the info right there. ARM 2, 8 MHz, 2 MB of RAM. Okay.
Yeah. So it's a 32-bit ARM CPU and looks like an Amiga 500.
Okay. So not 16-bit. My bad.
Yeah, 1632, whatever, had an 8-bit expansion slot somewhere. It's easier to explain Brexit than to explain this computer.
So it's going to be really hard.
Yes, it is.
We could do a whole show on that and not get it covered properly.
No, it's I think we can spend an entire show on crazy British computer hardware that was only sold on the islands.
However, if I'm not mistaken, didn't the Archimedes then turn into the base for the RISC machines?
Yeah, so this is RISC CPU, actually.
Yeah. And then from there, a bit of the Raspberry Pi.
Yeah. Keeping the good British tradition of, you know, cheap, affordable hardware.
Yeah. And you can actually run RISC OS on a Raspberry Pi. I have done that, and I should look into whether or not it's possible to make a demo using it that way, because it is actually kind of impressive to run it that way.
Mm-hmm.
In my case, it seems to run smoother, especially on the first model. And there are apparently people still selling commercial software for RISC OS.
There's still, you know, people are still making new software and new games for pretty much every older platform. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
Yeah.
So sure, why not for RISC OS?
Exactly.
The hardware it was designed for, it kind of died 20 years ago.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong with mid-range demos for any of these things. They're all. You know, we have.
This is why.
This scene really looks Amiga. Or Atari, for that matter.
Yeah, which is what you can compare this to. This is like an Amiga 500 and a half, or an ST and 3/4.
Like an STE.
Possibly, yeah. So it's all in the same. Black Zerk.
But there are more. He's able to actually pump more circles on the screen than in a 500. So that's rather impressive, actually, that scene.
Yeah, and that's. And I have no idea what the video capabilities of this thing are. If it has sprites or some other objects, whatever, I have no idea.
Yeah, the big question is it able? Does it have a blitter or not? And how do you draw lines?
With a pencil.
Yeah, that's difficult to do that so quickly, because when you're doing the eraser on the monitor, that you know, people tend to notice that when you're drawing.
But then you have to use your eraser in the V blends.
Yes.
We have now lost half the audience.
No, we've totally lost all of the audience.
Anyways, let's move on to PC stuff. This was one of the only decent PC releases at Nova. It was pretty weak in terms of PC stuff there. A lot more old school, which is kind of cool for the retro people.
That's exactly what Nova is for. It's for all these crazy ass old school things that never make it past the channel on a ferry.
That stay in England, in the United Kingdom.
It's like there's a bunch of demo sceners come there that you don't see anywhere else. They only come to Nova or other British parties. And there,
which is a problem in itself.
It makes it a cool party because of the people who you meet over there and who come over. But yeah, it is a kind of limited. You will now see somebody walk by in the background, by the way, who needs to grab something.
And he's hello.
No, I'm on the wrong screen.
Yes, well, you missed it.
You missed
anyway,
it, yeah.
So,
hold on, wait.
So with Nova, talking to some organizers of other German parties a few weeks ago, it was like, it's the only party that they don't want to miss because it's so cool to get there. Just going there is an adventure.
I hear it's like almost in the middle of nowhere because it was the best place they got, like in a little town.
It's in Budley Salterton.
Yes, it's a little town and there is like no proper road to get there.
No, there's a proper road. It's a proper British road.
Oh, yes, of course, yes.
Like for goats?
So it's
horses. Horses.
Obviously.
It is a road sized for like a horse and carriage and not for like two big trucks crossing each other.
And chances are that road has been there since the Roman times.
Yes, very much so.
A lot of the roads in England are set up that way because that was the first organized effort to put roads in.
Can I try to say something interesting about the intro itself? I mean, I liked it. What did you guys think about it?
I actually had to stop watching Twitch and only watch it on the other location because...
Yeah, that's what you do.
It kills the encoder.
It's killing the encoder and watching the killed encoder, on even less bandwidth. So the answer is that I need to watch this on my actual PC that actually... can play.
Yeah. It's an interesting thing that we're starting to see a lot of demos that need to be played on proper machines because the problem is the encoder. Yeah.
I think that's better. We had the MFX trilogy of all those noise demos.
Yeah, which looked shit when encoded.
Which is why all of them were the proper releases were non-lossy.
Mm-hmm. Which were huge, like 4 gigabytes and stuff.
There were 4 gigabytes and things. I hosted those for a long time. I still have the originals. When we go to PeerTube, we'll be able to do that as well. Because we'll actually be able to control the whole thing rather than having Google decide what the best thing is.
Best thing is to look horrible. Everyone knows that. Anyways, moving on. In August, we had Evoke. Evoke was a pretty cool party. I went there. It was fun. This was one of the releases.
You could mention that there was another party, but we've already had a show on it.
Yes, Assembly.
And there was also Solskogen.
I think I completely forgot about Solskogen, which is kind of bad on my part.
Yes. Yes, it is. And there was also... the party that is always at the wrong time in Germany that everybody is invited to. Is it in Bremen or?
Yeah, Bremen. Yeah, Nordlicht. Yeah.
And Nordlicht also had some really interesting releases. Halsey's demo on the Nintendo DS was there, wasn't it? Or was it released at Evoke? I think it was from.
Nintendo DS demo.
Yeah, Skate Central or something like this. I guess I'm going to have to find it then. Which platform is this?
This is for the Mega Drive.
This is Mega Drive.
Yeah, that previous routine was like really, really cool. Let's see here.
I'm getting more and more annoyed that like the first generation EverDrive hardly takes any proper demos on the Mega Drive, which is the one I have.
We need to get some way of getting more Seeners EverDrives and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
I have one.
You have an EverDrive version 1 or 2?
2.
Yeah. I think DDT's was a version 1. A friend of mine has it. I have to get one. I now have a Mega Drive 2.
I got the EverDrive thinking that I was going to develop on the Mega Drive. That funny idea. And then I realized I don't have time to even develop on PC. How the hell am I going to find time to develop for the Mega Drive?
Well, the answer is so you can watch demos on it.
That's what you're using for.
I haven't gotten to the part of getting the Mega Drive working with the monitors. It gives me a gray image. I need an old CRT thing. Or a converter of some sort.
What you do is get an OSSD these days.
To watch old school demos, I use this NES Mini.
Oh my god, that's cheating. Does he have like a VGA output?
It's an HDMI, but it shows a better picture than on a PC emulator.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
If you're going to do one of those mini thingies, you might as well get like a Raspberry box and put an emulator on it.
No.
It's also HDMI output.
No. This is pre-configured out of the box. Drop a file. Yay, works. I am a lazy fuck. I prefer this.
Also, cost-wise, a Raspberry Pi plus the case, plus the power, plus the SD card, plus HDMI cable.
I picked this one up in a thrift store in France for 25 euros.
I purchased. That's not bad. I have 3 PlayStation classics. The first two, actually, I bought them when they first came out, so I paid more for those than I should have. But the other two that I bought, I got for like 50 euros. And that thing is completely hackable.
Mm-hmm.
And the controllers that come with it are worth the price.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I want to come back to the effect with the large sprites that we just saw in this demo.
Can we rewind?
Can we? Yes, we can. But I think it comes back later in the demo again anyway, but we can rewind it. So this is C64 for the record.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for those at home playing along and guess the platform. So this is like so completely simple, but it's so awesomely executed.
Yeah, this part right here.
It's like, yeah. This takes no CPU time, no memory, and it's so well done. It's like, yeah, it's so cool, even I could do it. It's like, it's that stupidly simple.
And this was part of the alternative compo at Evoke.
Which was fucking huge. Place.
Yeah, it was really a big compo. A lot of entries and a lot of high quality stuff.
But that's what the thing is, that if there's one thing at Evoke is that they like to throw wild old school, it's all thrown together into one big ass fucking compo. So that sometimes things tend to drown out into the background. Personal opinion, you feel free to completely disagree.
I mean, I kind of like the compo, but I thought it was weird that they also had a wild compo, which kind of doesn't make much sense when you already have this alternative demo compo.
Yeah, it doesn't.
They had the interactive compo, and on the interactive, some people play stuff there, but I don't.
It's not that it doesn't make any sense, but it's confusing.
So we ended up having alternative demo, animation, and PC demo combo. Those were the main combos. And then there's the interactive combo. And people, well, interactive is mostly for games. I've been mostly participating on the interactive, but mostly because I wanted to do something with a chance of actually winning anything, because not many people participate on the interactive compo, or not as much as in the other compos. So that's mostly the main reason I've been using that one. Anyways, this was a part of the alternative demo. It won the alternative demo compo. There was one more that I wanted to play from that compo, which I don't think it's... Which I think it's this. I hope it's this. Yes, it's this. New School Reunion by Rift and Hoi Program. A mixed venture between Manchatronic and Gasman. This was for the Pico 8. But it does feel like more old school than new school. Mm-hmm. And I do think that it's interesting that we have been having so many Pico 8 entries. I mean, it kind of felt like that Yobe had killed the Pico 8 as a category after Rock for Metal. But a lot of people still doing stuff for the Pico 8 and a lot of interesting stuff. Seems like
I'm not sure how... I mean... I don't understand how you can suggest that it was killed after somebody released a good demo.
Because it feels like it's gonna be impossible to do something better than that. At least that's how I feel.
Well, that's not the point. The point isn't to make something better. The point is to make something...
It's my 15-year-old argument. If you wait to release something until you're better than what's currently out there, you're never going to release anything at all.
Then you're going to end up with nearly 25 years waiting for Deep Large 7.
Yeah, but the thing is, if you want... The question for me is that you're learning a new platform, and if you're learning a new platform, it's because you want to do something cool with that, but if you feel like the platform has already been explored to its full potential...
Then you fucked up.
Then...
Frankie, sold my C64 and moved entirely to the Amiga when I saw that there was a Sinus Scroller that was done by Paninaro of Occult on C64 saying, okay, everything has been done.
Mm-hmm.
35 years later, look at all these fucking demos that we've got. There's no way in hell that was over. I should have kept it.
Yeah.
Never think that everything has been done. Something you can... Now you can go, Frankie.
Yeah, no, it's like, basically, it's like you have to put self-achievable goals. If you're going to move to a new platform and you want to make immediately the best demo ever, you're never going to release anything. You know? If you go to a new platform, create something with a logo, a scroller, and some music. Achievable goals.
I mean, yeah, I completely agree with that.
Also, one of the things that people were saying about Assembly, and we can talk about Assembly now because it's in August, mm-hmm. People were saying, oh, Assembly wasn't very good this year. All the productions sucked. No, they didn't. There were a lot of productions that were really good that were made by newer folks. The fact that we didn't have this huge thing that nobody could reach, like you're saying, with a new thing, that's not the point. The point is make something, actually do something. And it's better if we don't have blockbusters all the fucking time, because then we don't discourage people who are just starting out. I mean, you've been around a while, P.S. You've been making stuff, but if you look at the Pico 8 thing and somebody makes a good demo and you go, oh, well, I can't compete with that, so I may as well quit. I mean, and you know as well as I
get your
do
point.
That there are
I get
loads
your
of
point.
People like you and me that are like, oh, shit, I can't beat it, so I may as well quit, and we get defeatist. Don't get defeatist.
I agree. It's a bit of an emo position of me to go like, okay, I have all these ideas of things that I want to do, including a Pico 8 demo, and then I ended up focusing on stuff that I think it's more within reach instead of going for stuff that I think it's like overblown with like completely already like fully explored to some extent. No. I know it's impossible to be fully explored, but I mean, it's been explored to a degree that I would not very easily reach, so there's not that much reward. But I completely agree with you that that's the wrong mindset to get into things, and that will only end up you not getting into things and actually doing stuff.
When I am starting out and I run into the same problem, and when I start out, I need to just start simple, and then I iterate on top of it. What happens is I run out of time, and I don't get time to iterate, but I'll, you know, if I've actually made small things, I can build on that. If I try to set something up that's big, I will run out of time, just like you were saying. And this is where also things like the Shader Showdown, which is, you know, you get half an hour to make something, or Preacher.
The One Scene Compo. I really like the concept of One Scene Compo, yeah.
Or Preacher was saying, when you start out, try making 4Ks, because then you're automatically limited to what you can do in 4K. So then you're like, okay, I can't really pack that much grandiose stuff in. What can I pack in? And your mindset changes.
Yep. Meanwhile, we've been watching FR093 Technology, made by Barrow.
I like Barrow's demos. I don't know who made this thing.
This one was actually made by me, and it's I'm PS of Enough Records apparently on this particular production.
Right. So this is interactive because that's the only way you want to take part in.
No. On this particular Evoke, I participated in more than the interactive. Hey Genio, welcome to the stream.
Hey Genio.
Oh, well, Genio is here, so I will have to play Soldat, his invitation for Inertia as well.
Yes, yes, you will.
Yes.
I got a lot of positive feedback on this one, so I was happy about
that. It's great, Dem. I really like what you did with it. The problem is that I don't want to talk over it. I think it should not be talked over. I think we should give people the URL and so that they can see it. This is WebGL, yes?
It's native Canvas. It's not WebGL yet. Okay. On later demos, right. I use WebGL. This one doesn't. It's just normal.
But it runs
JavaScript
in the browser.
Canvas. Yeah, it's a browser demo.
Yeah, it's a browser demo.
So, I mean, everybody should be able to use it, except probably those of us using MorphOS.
If you have a really crappy laptop, it's probably going to crawl a lot. But other than that, it should work fine.
Well, then it's just more art.
Yeah, I just wanted to explore the style transfer things, because I think it's really underexplored, especially in the demo scene. I haven't seen anyone do stuff with that. So I've been trying to accumulate enough kind of that kind of content and see what I can do with it. And it's been interesting, like an interesting way to have a fresh take into the demo scene. So it doesn't feel like, you know, I'm reinventing the cube or reinventing the wheel. So I really enjoyed doing this, and I think it turned out pretty good. I'm happy with the feedback that I got on this one.
You're like really close to reinventing the circle twist on this one.
Yeah.
Which I mean as a compliment, by the way. Which I mean.
Yeah.
Also, using piano alone is... so often we have demos that are just, you know, more dance oriented, and this is the type of thing that, well, would fit nicely into a collection like Demo Vibes.
Mm-hmm. I didn't do the music on this one. It's from a guy from the Enough Records. I wanted to do the original music because I was playing around with a hand pan, and that's where I got the idea for doing this kind of thing. And then I ended up, like, this friend of mine had this track, and like, okay, this track is better than any track that I'm going to be able to record.
Does this friend of yours have a name? I mean, I gave you the opportunity to say who it was so we could go and listen to more of his stuff, and you're like, yeah, it's some other guy.
Himalaya. Himalaya. The link is there. If you go to the page of the demo, the link is there.
Okay.
This was one of my favorite demos from the compo, the Limp Ninja stuff. Really love the style that they have. I would say the title, but it's in Korean, and I can't speak Korean, so I have no fucking clue what it means.
Actually, you should be able to learn Korean in about an hour, how to read it.
If I copy-paste it and go to translate...
Well, you could do it that way, but actually, Korean, Hangul, each one of the... Hangul and Finnish are similar in that each one of the symbols represents a sound. And apparently Hangul, like the round thing, is actually, I believe, an O sound, because you shape your mouth like an O. So each one of the things is sort of how you shape your mouth.
Oh.
So apparently it's really easy how to learn how to read it. Hmm. Then you have to actually understand what you're saying, which is a whole different ball game, which is why I can read Finnish.
Pronounce Finnish well, but then can't understand shit.
I can't pronounce it very well, but I can read it, and then I have to work further on, you know.
I'm going to come back on the VHS thing, having been to Shifter's place for his birthday a few months ago.
Good. Is he still working on it?
Yes, he's currently hoarding new old stock VHS tapes.
Oh, yeah, I knew he was. He showed me the picture.
I think I stood next to the stack and next to the mastering Sony VHS player. So yes, they're working on it. But the duplication is going to become an issue because you want all the copies to be in as good quality as you want, and you know, if you make all copies from one VHS player, you kill that one player.
Poro is disagreeing with me on the pronunciation thing, but I have a feeling that it might be also. We could ask Shifter, because
Porocion speaks Korean.
I don't know, but he is disagreeing that he said that according to actual Korean speakers, no. But
people are asking why it's gone full screen, because I put it full screen, because it deserves full screen attention. I'll change it back when we are talking more.
I personally don't understand why you don't run the whole thing full screen. I really don't.
Usually so people understand who is talking right now, and also we see the chat, and that kind of works. But I have this thing set up on Stream Deck now that I can switch back and forth real easily. So I thought, oh, I haven't used it all the show yet. I'm going to use it now and make it cool. And people are like, ah, it's broken.
Yes. Prepare to check the full screen.
I would just say you should run the majority of the show with the demos full screen.
Yeah, I agree. That's what I'm going to try to do from this moment forward. Anyways, this demo is called A World Without Lights. It's by some French people, including music by my dear friend Alkama, and it looks pretty good, and it sounds pretty good. It's a pretty good demo. I liked it.
I also liked it.
A lot of good releases at Evoke this year.
Yes. And then something odd won.
We'll get to that when we reach it, I guess. Hey, Bruce, how's it going, man? We just saw your demo. Hope you catched it. The Hangul in that particular demo should be good. I even took my Korean intern to Evoke to make sure it checked out. Okay,
yeah,
good to know.
I remember meeting the Korean intern.
Yeah, okay, so, but what was the result? Was the intern happy?
Maybe he just didn't want to humiliate you with your bad Korean.
But yeah, no. Speaking of demos that need subtitles, that was also one of them.
The intern described it as a surreal experience. Okay, sounds good. The demos, or your demo, or the demo party event overall.
Well, demo parties are truthfully a surreal experience, yes, because, well, as Blackle says, you know, you go up to any table and there are people making things, and you ask them, what are you working on? And they show you, and then you get ideas, and you work together, and it's great. And that is extremely rare for some reason in today's world. You know, if... if you go to a common working space,
they tell you to fuck off when you ask what they're doing.
You go to a coffee shop, it's like, no, go away. And I mean, in some ways, you know, you do need to be able to say, no, I'm working on something myself, but for it to be all the time and everywhere. So yeah, it shouldn't be a surreal experience, but in many cases it is. Also, you know, so often people are actually interested in making things that you forget about, you know, other, like, I mean, we have, you had the difficulty earlier, with Beaton, and it's like, oh, yeah, completely forgot that, you know,
sex changed.
Yes, Beaton changed genders, and you know, for many of us, it's like, but they're the same person, so it's like, okay, I hope you're happier now, right? Cool. And you move on from there, and every so many other places, it's like, oh no, you have to make a big deal out of it. Are you happy? Yes.
It's curious that the demo scene does seem to have a larger transgender community somehow present than other scenes. Although I'm not that active in other scenes to really know, but I have known what the first people that I know that are transgender are from the demo scene overall. And I mean, for me, it was enlightening because I didn't know much about that community besides what I see on TV, which is usually, not very well portrayed, or I assume that it's not very well portrayed. So it's more interesting to have more information about all sorts of scenes, not just transgender, but you know, other kind of people that don't think the same way you do. They have more right-wing ideas, left-wing ideas, stuff like that. That's one of the plus things that I think on the demo scene is that it's like a representation of people at large, different nationalities, different ideas of how to do things, different emotional ways of being as well. Like, you have assholes, you have people that are like introverts, you have all kinds of different people. And we come together at demo parties and we just talk and have this connection because of the demo scene.
I have friends who are transgender who are from outside the demo scene, and yeah, the reaction that people have within the demo scene is completely different than what they have outside. In the demo scene, it seems to be more, hey, cool, you're making something. Outside, it's like, oh, I need to apply a whole bunch of labels to you. And then, you know, the best thing talking about the labels and the demo scene was brilliant Atari ST demo by Church of
not sure which one you're mentioning.
It's not the Church of Atari. It's the one, I'll see if I can find it. We should play it at the end. It's a fantastic demo. It was nominated for a Scene.org award or for a Meteorix, but I think it was Scene.org award.
A bit insane that it's the XIA demo, probably.
Also, it's really cool to see all the people in the chat that I haven't seen for a while. It's
I wanted to mention two things. First thing, I really like what they do with that Rebels demo that we just watched. Because usually I don't like Rebels demo, but that post effect that they did with the particles made it quite watchable and quite enjoyable. So well done, Rebels, on that thing. It's probably a one-trick pony thing. Probably won't work very well on the next demo they do, but it was pretty good. And then we had this demo, which is Red Heaven, which got a lot of controversy because it's a bit cliche and it uses a lot of scenes from other places, which I personally think it's good. You should draw inspirations from as many different places as you see fit. So I don't particularly hate the demo, but I don't really like it either. So I have mixed feelings about it, but I think you guys have more strong feelings about it, so I'm gonna let you guys pick. So Frankie, Truck, what do you think about this demo?
I remember this, like, the the first time you watch it, and I think with this one, I'm gonna pump it up again. The music did a lot for me.
The music is actually is. I think you said it best at the party place. This is the type of thing that you just play in your car and you just crank.
Yeah. So driving in a car, driving around on this soundtrack, yeah. The soundtrack is what carries the demo for me. The rest is, as you said, it's random video clips from random places thrown together. And while it is from an artistic point of view, it can perfectly make sense. It's debatable if it is all self-created by the people who put the demo together. And I think that's where most of the controversy comes from, which sadly takes swings it into an overall negative view, because it's, you know, people worked on this, people, you know, polished this, they did all the timing, and then, you know, people tend to focus on the negative aspects here.
Adekid is saying something interesting in the chat. There was a demo from previous year that had this a lot of space anime things, was by the same creator. So he really enjoys exploring, like taking clips from anime and stuff like that and creating like a narrative around it somehow. So it's his thing. So I sort of get that. But I don't know, the demo didn't really do much for me. It felt a mix of anime with non-anime stuff.
Then what Haruki says, I don't think it gets hate. You know, people don't hate it. It's a demo. People have worked on this. People see the work.
Mm-hmm. Some people didn't like that it got placed first. But then again, Evoke results were a bit weird this year overall.
I think the whole issue with it is that people thought it got name voted to the top.
Yeah, and that's a bit stupid because those guys aren't that known. They're French and they're not that known to get name voted. So I don't think it was that. In my humble opinion, of course.
Wasn't that a TRSI production?
I think it was, but
yep.
Most of the TRSI...
That's the main thing, is that people were thinking that TRSI...
No, it's Hoodlum. Hoodlum.
Well, but Hoodlum is the member of TRSI. Hoodlum is the... No, it's Unix of Hoodlum. That's right. It's Unix of Hoodlum releasing under TRSI. Anyway, old Amiga guys, and people were accusing it of being name voting. As far as that goes, who cares? It's voting. When did the correct party ever win? Or when did the correct demo ever win a party? But, as far as the demo actually goes, also, and Genio is singing here.
This should have won the compo as well, the animation compo, and it didn't. It got third place. In my humble opinion, of course. I'm biased, obviously.
I think I liked the demo a lot more, the Hoodlum demo a lot more than other people. I remember Shifter saying, does that guy have an issue and is he getting help for it? I think a lot of people saw it as much more violent than what I did. Mm-hmm. For me, a lot of Unix's demos, they tend to have a message that I tend to agree with, that is that the overarching structure of capitalism and the way that we're being invaded, our personal freedoms and so forth. I tend to agree with him on the way that his demos present that. I think that what he has done recently, though, is stepping away from making that the focal point, because people were not listening to that, or they were saying, oh, it's too political. So I think by kind of mixing that with some other visuals or something, I think he's getting the point further in to people.
I mean, there are a lot of demos that show like aggressive gore stuff. Like a lot of Cocoon demos have that, and
yep.
You know, it's just how people purge the stuff they have inside. It's common. It's known.
Yeah.
It's not.
Or yeah, that was the thing. I guess the new Apple thing is the new most extreme Apple. And I went to look at it hoping that the front cover that they'd actually tried to rip off Napalm Death, and no, of course they haven't. So it's nowhere. It's not extreme at all. It's just basically a lame machine. So I should just redo this old Apple thing here completely with Napalm Death.
Bad apple with Napalm Death sounds good. Anyways, this was the invitation for Inertia Demo Party.
I you know, one of the great things about this particular production is I know where it was filmed.
Yes. Was straight from the location of last year's Inertia.
Which was a very, very nice party. And I am sorry that I missed it, but we discussed it earlier.
Yes. Let's not get into that again.
P.S. I did paste those the two.
Yeah, I've seen
there.
It. I've seen them.
I don't know when. I think you should show before we move on to off of August. We should show the one from July.
Okay. Let's watch the rest of Evoke stuff first. Namely, this one was the 4K that should either have won or got second place, in my humble opinion, at Evoke 4K. It's by LJ and Virgil. And it has shit tons of content 4K.
Yeah.
And I was completely mind blown by it. And I was completely amazed that it only got fourth place at the results. Just the sound production on this. Like getting all those metal sounds and stuff.
Yes. As Bomba is saying, this has an amazing soundtrack for 4K. Although I know Nobi had tried to do quite a bit more with the soundtrack of his 4K at Assembly.
So
which kind of comes in enough. So if people are packing better sound to their 4Ks, you know, and they're doing more with the sound, that gives less space to do visuals. And sometimes people react to that with, oh, it wasn't very good because the visuals weren't there. But the sound was.
Okay, so is this a soft synth or is this MIDI?
It's Farklang. So it's soft synth.
Okay.
Yeah, there's no way you could get the noise thing that's going on right now. And
that's what I mean. So, and yeah, of course, you know, Farklang is, it's Limassonic powers, I guess. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but this one works. And then, yeah, you do get the Comet O. It's like a flyby demo. It's like boring as fuck. Nothing is happening, but yeah, it's...
Yeah, but it has a theme, and it's cohesive.
And all of this in just 4K is like, okay, sure.
Not to mention there's tremendous amount of detail.
Yeah,
I mean, people that complain about, you know, flybys and so forth are the same sort of people that can't sit in a train and watch the landscape go past, which is an amazing thing to do.
Watching the landscape from a train in Finland in winter?
No, but say if you're in the south
night.
Of France, going across the end, if you're going from Nîmes to where did I fly? Anyway, I went across the from Marseille to Nice on the train, mm-hmm. and then also went from Nîmes down to there. And there are so many different landscapes and different areas in that, and plus you get to see the Mediterranean. It really is amazing to see that. Also, this is from our friends in South America.
Yeah. This is also very much a train buy, as Genio is calling it, because we seem to be on the rails and always going there.
This is totally a rail shooter.
It looked pretty good. It sounded pretty decent. Some people gave them a little bit of shit because it wasn't, like, very innovative, but it looks pretty good. I liked it.
I think they missed the part where it goes off of the rails.
Because it changes slightly. That's what's interesting about it. It's not just one effect all the time. It is one effect, but it changes enough that it feels like it's different.
I would agree that it probably does have some pacing issues, but as this guy's are normally on C64, pacing issues are something that you kind of have to learn the hard way when coming from the C64. There's so much timing that you have to wait for that when you no longer have to wait for it, you might think that you're going too fast.
Someone dropped something.
I did. I dropped my
Ben?
No, my
USB
magnetic
drive?
Magnetic cube puzzle.
Oh?
Oh, okay. So now you can restart it because it's teleport.
Yes.
Anyways, the winner, 4K, was by Slurpee, and I was pretty darn good. It's called Glitch Rider. It's One Trick Pony.
This was really, really good. I know somebody who was not trying to figure out what was good about it.
Good thing is that it's like glitched.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's fantastic the way that it was done, but the person, and Frankie knows who I'm talking about, they did not get this at all.
Oh. Yeah, this is one of those things that takes multiple viewings to get.
I liked it the first time.
I have to agree.
Yeah, but you make like weird canvas demos with circles that change color.
they're
everybody does that.
Point.
You know, I want to rotate the cubes that shiny, okay? No, I'm defending my demographic here.
I also, this was this a 4K or a 1K?
4K.
It's 4K, I think.
Right. I think the transitioning is the thing that gets me about this, is that mm-hmm. the way that the transition is done, we've seen it in numerous other things, like in video it's used a lot, but it really worked well here. Also, I find it interesting that he did not go with a complete black and white, but instead with a gray.
Because if it's completely black and white, then it's like totally coded colors.
No, it's much. You remember how on the old Apple, or when you have just the when you have to dither with just the two colors, how it has a mm-hmm. different effect, and you get the moire patterns.
Yeah, true, but you know, this day, if you're unsure about any coded colors, take black and white. So this is going out on the limb and taking a risk, so this is good.
What we're watching right now is actually from Datastorm, no longer Evoke. We have one more demo we have to go back for from Evoke. And I was checking the list of Soulskogan stuff, and I think we did go over it on the show we did about Assembly. So I think we're good about Soulskogan.
Okay.
We can still play some stuff from there if you want, but I think we at least Construct, I remember showing. Probably the Cocoon demo as well. And a hymn to Hippocarpus. Anyways, Datastorm, eh? Same weekend as Assembly. That didn't stop them from having some nice releases. It kind of ruined the idea for Assembly to have like Amiga productions on the old school compo.
is something we are not very happy about. It has been expressed that there is no ill will. It's no longer being said that that assembly is doesn't have any scene relevance or scene releases, which is something that we were hearing for a while.
Maybe for the Amiga and C64 scene, it doesn't feel that way. But I think at least Bright Light would disagree.
Not just Bright Light, also Yope and the people that have actually been working hard for, 10 plus years to continue that. And they've been under pressure to just have it no longer there, and they've... really, the reason why it exists is because people still want to have it as a meaningful thing at assembly and have actual, old school demos. And when people are complaining that, it doesn't have any relevance, and then they go and maybe do something at a different location because supposedly it doesn't have any. Well, that's exactly the opposite of being constructive. Instead, if you want to have your platform shown more, you should support the parties that actually are trying to do it, rather than, splintering off and saying, "Well,
we're going to do
I'm
our
gonna
own."
Make my own. I'm going to take my ball and go home is essentially what it is.
When did DataStorm first get created, though? I mean, DataStorm is pretty old as well, isn't it? 2010. So, they've been around for quite a while, and they know that weekend is always assembly.
When did assembly start?
A lot longer than that, that's true.
Yeah.
But I mean...
Yeah. So, I don't think they can claim any sort of...
Chuck, stop playing with the magnet thingy. We can hear it.
Yeah. Also, the discussion of this party is older, therefore it has more right to something, and something is bullshit.
I mean, they clearly wanted to have a party of their own instead of going to assembly every summer.
That's the point, right there. They wanted to have a party of their own rather than going to assembly, and that just kind of stinks.
Which makes sense for them. I mean, not everyone likes to travel all the time. We had this very same discussion about the inertia. I mean, do we want to cater for something that might possibly someone come, or should we focus on the people who are actually here and will most probably not go to, in our case, from inertia to deadline? And we ended up concluding that we should focus on the local people, because those are the ones who will actually most probably come to the party. So
yeah,
I can understand the concept of other parties clashing
schedules here. Is that DataStorm does not cater to local people only.
Well, yeah, but that's because they grew too big. And then they started trying to get the Amiga and the C64 scene there.
No, it isn't.
Well, they always tried from 2010, they always tried to get everyone from assembly to go there.
When it was in winter, it was the party. Period. For old school. It was bigger than everywhere else. It was for C64, it was the thing that you went to other than X. For Amiga, it pretty much was the party.
Did they start on winter or did they start in summer?
Yes, they started in winter.
Okay. I guess they changed the summer in 2017?
Yes.
Okay.
So for some of us, it's first of all, it means that we don't have a party to go to in winter anymore, which sucks. And then the second thing is they moved it right on top of assembly, which has been there for so long. And essentially, took away the possibility for people to want to release at assembly because this was a, for old school, because it previously was this huge old school thing.
Yeah.
So it really, we're glad that the party exists. We really like it. We just don't like the timing. And at one time, some things were said by some people, which have been retracted, that stung. And I even made some comments on stream that I had to retract about it. But yeah, it's... Basically, it comes down to this. It's the same type of bullshit as the Brexit thing, okay? Yeah, Nova was never... And before that, Sundown, these were never UK-exclusive parties. Everybody was there, but it's going to end up being that because of Brexit. And then there are some people in the UK, I remember, you know, D-Man and so forth, and loads of people in the North that were trying to make these, oh no, UK-only bullshit scene things. The scene is not about, you know, splintering off and having your own private scene. That guy in the U.S. Tried to do that as well with the whole, with the
pilgrimage?
Whole, oh, yeah, pilgrimage with the whole, oh, Euro trash, we're coming for you. That's not what the scene is about. The scene is about going to a party, seeing people that are making things, and making things yourself and making friends. It's a social aspect of it. And by splintering, I don't like seeing that.
I think we have too many parties. That's my personal opinion. We have too many parties and not enough people creating.
I think you might be right. I think you might be 100% right there.
No, looking at the amount of parties, like the is like when you look at it, like 10, 15 years ago, you would have all these tons of C64 only parties, Amiga only parties, PC only parties. So no, there's always room for a party somewhere, but then, you know, you have to realize, okay, you're doing, you know, you cannot be the 255 people person event from the get-go. But if you say, hey, we see an opportunity here to have a party, let's organize one and see what happens. Like you shouldn't go with the argument, oh no, we cannot do a party because there's already too many of them. I strongly disagree on that.
I mean, for us in Portugal, it's pretty easy. It's just not any other party. We have to create one or we don't have a party here. So we never really had that issue with, oh, we have too many parties going on. We never had that problem to deal with. But I see, like, international parties, like, how it becomes that. Like, when I look at the map and the dates, I see a lot of different parties on, like, the French scene. If you take a look at the French scene, there are a lot of French demo parties, but a lot of them are very small. And they're very, like, specific scenes, specific niche. Like, you don't see many foreigners going to those parties. And it's not because they're badly localized, it's just they're focused on the local scene.
No, but when they, like, specialize in, like, Amstrad or Auric, which are French systems, it's limited by itself.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
Which is, yeah, the French demo parties might not be the most open ones to foreigners, because also they're not announced outside of France for many things that I have.
And there's the language barrier as well, because they pretty much only want to speak French there.
No, not for the Belgians, not for the Swiss. Yeah. You know, and they all do. They all do a
basic
of English. Yeah, you know, people from Montreal can like bloody fly in. There's an excellent a connection between Montreal and Paris. So no, but. What is the thing that I suddenly found out, like, oh, there was a French demo party last weekend at 2 hours drive away from me, and I didn't know about it.
Yeah, so they don't announce it much.
You go to demoparty.net or whatever, like, is it announced? No, it was announced on this, like, one specific form, and if you're not on there, then, well, tough.
So that's clearly they only want people from that forum.
Well, yes, happy circle jerk.
Yeah.
And that's what I don't want to see.
Exactly.
That's what I don't want to see.
I mean, if that works for them, that's fine. I don't see anything wrong with it. I don't see how I will ever
go to
that
I
party.
I see a lot wrong with it.
But then they'll start screaming, the scene is dead, because, you know, you're killing it.
Also, I mean, okay, bottom line, if we could work something out, but where the folks at DataStorm and the folks at Assembly could have a joint thing where, you know, it worked out that way.
Frankie, someone on the chat is asking what demo party you were referring to, if it wasn't on Demo Zoo.
I don't know anymore. It might have been a few years ago. I really do not remember the name of a specific party, but I know there are some smaller French parties in northern France or at a few hours driving, which were like, oh, that was last weekend. I could have gone. Would I have known about it?
Okay, you don't know. Truck, sorry to cut you off. Please go back.
No problem. Well, we're watching Skate Station now from Nordlicht. But I actually kind of want to just point out what Bomba said in conjunction with what I was saying. We're one of the issues that we're going to run into even more in the coming years is, how many demo parties can you attend because of the distance involved? And then, okay, what's the carbon footprint of that? And, you know, does it make sense to fly everywhere? I mean, the price might be cheap, but what's the effect overall? Is it better to actually do something where you're doing a remote thing? And in some ways, it's not the same because you're not actually sitting in the same room as the people. But if you have to do that like once a year and or twice a year at a big thing, and then the smaller things get to work together. I don't know. There are ways we can do this in future that are going to be better for everyone overall.
On the footprint thing, and I know it's so being like high up in the Nordics, it's not easy. But what you see for Central Europe is that night trains are coming back. So they're starting with sleeper trains north, south, east, west. We're getting one from Brussels to say Vienna. So if you want to go to Bratislava for a party, we can go by train now.
Yeah.
So that's luckily that's all coming back. Okay, it takes longer to get there, but then the travel is part of the experience and the party. And don't forget that in the US. There is a party that actually happens on the train, so.
Yep, the one that actually happens on the train is like a really awesome thing. And we've talked about, some of us have talked about taking a train to like revision, instead of taking a plane. It just is gonna take longer. But on the other hand, if you can sleep and you get a compartment, you can work on your freaking production on the way down.
That's also true. That's an important thing. And you get to sightsee a little bit, get yourself a little holiday time, some R&R.
I mean, there's something about you when you're, one of the things when we would travel to kindergarten by car / van, whatever, I actually really preferred taking that long trip because I could see things, and it helped me to unwind a lot more than getting on a plane, getting rushed, flying there, having the party, then decompressing at home by having the hangover here. It was so much better to actually just get in the car, drive there, see things. Yeah, it's a long trip. Yeah, your legs get cramped. But you got to see things, and you got to talk to people, and it just was so much better for me, at least, to do it that way. And I think, the South Bus, when they go to TRSAC, I think it's similar, although it's a shorter distance.
I understand what you're saying, but I still feel a bit lazy. I want to like not spend one whole day traveling when I could just be there.
There are some people that just doesn't work for. I mean, but there are.
Well, no, it's all about options. Like, if you say like, whatever I'm flying in, that's sure. if you want to like have an option and say, hey, I want to like take this and this into account, you have all your options. You don't have to. It's an option and you're completely free to choose. And that's what the nice part is. It's like making things mandatory never works. Like forcing people into being ashamed of something never works because that'll make people defensive and it won't work. But give them options.
Yeah. I mean, we already have taxes on things, and it's been debatable by climate change advocates that we should be taxing more the stuff that is more pollutant, which I personally agree with. I think that makes sense. That would make the airplanes a lot less cost-effective to be run. So either you would pay more and you would be compensating the environment through your taxation, or you would find alternative ways to get there.
And I'm fine with that level. It's kind of like, well, the whole concept of that I don't want to help anybody else out is.
I'm gonna steal the topic now because talking about like small parties and let's do one because we can. This is invitation for RSync, which is coming up in. Actually 1 month in Brussels that I'm part of the organizing team. So yeah, we had a like, okay, oh, we have a venue, we have a date, let's just do something and see where we end up.
Also, it was during a period of time when there weren't any other parties.
Oh yes, because it's in the depth of winter.
You have good heating on the venue, I hope?
Well, yes, and if not, we can cuddle.
I'm big and fluffy, we can cuddle.
Yes.
Also, it doesn't the hotels around the area seem to be several of them.
The good thing is that hotels in Brussels in the weekend are plenty and cheap because most of the hotels cater towards business and the European thing, which in the weekend is empty.
The funny thing is, I actually found a four-person apartment, which was nearby, which was even cheaper than the hotel.
Mm-hmm, yep.
But I think everybody has now booked their hotels.
No, I think if you ask around, you can.
Well, I might, because I didn't actually book the hotel yet. I'm asking the
wall. And if not, you have a big place all for yourself.
Yes, that's very possible. But I actually comparing the size of the bed at the one hotel is nicer, and I think I will just go ahead and do that because I kind of need to
have space.
I need to de-stress again.
Almost sounds like you're stressed at work, truck.
Yeah, imagine that.
Anyways, let's talk about the demos from September. This was released at Xenium. It's called Simulacrum by Oftentide, or is it the other way around? Let me check. It's called Simulacrum by Oftentide.
Kato did the music. That's interesting. I haven't seen anything from Kato for a while.
He's still active, apparently.
Yeah.
And Xenium is a very interesting party because they were 20 years inactive and they decided to resurrect the party because apparently Riverwash is no more. And it worked pretty well for them. They got a lot of releases, a lot of cool stuff. This one got second places for the MS-DOS. Actually, it's for Windows, but it's like low resolution, MS-DOS resolution, 320 by 240.
But what platform was this?
It's technically Windows, but I think it's more DOS than Windows.
Right.
It's software rendered at 320 by 240, but it's for Windows.
Right. Okay,
huh. Cool.
I am not against this concept.
They just wanted more frame rates, the bastards.
Magitronic is asking if it's the shaders on the CPU one, which might actually be what it is.
I don't think it is.
Hmm.
I don't think it is. I'm looking at the README file. Low-res software rendering CPU-only code engine that emulates the style of the 90s. So, no.
So, software rendering.
Yeah.
Because the style of the 90s is software rendering.
Yep.
Yeah.
It was coded by Hollow One, which was like when I started my demo scene career back in 98 or something, was all, one of the Polish guys who I swapped emails with. I think he belonged to one of the first groups that I was in, Label, at some point. Before I decided to quit the demo scene and start a new group a few months after.
There was just a comment from Hardcade that with Demo Bit not happening this year, but it is happening. It's happening October 9th through 11th,
yep.
2020.
Yeah, it's like not Demo Bit.
Yeah, and it's not Demo Bit, I guess. I don't know.
It might be called something else.
Yes, with Demo Bit not happening in February, yes. I wonder how this demo will look on my full HD 4K monitor.
Pixelated.
With big pixels. I wonder if it's just actually...
Nothing wrong with that.
Well, I'm just wondering if it's going to smooth it or not.
Yeah, that'll depend on your monitor. I hope I hope it won't.
Yeah, I would hope it won't too. I'm going to have to see. That's an interesting sample. Stick 'em. I've never heard that in any productions by Carl B. And I certainly don't know what rap song it comes from originally. I'm glad you showed this one. I hadn't seen it, and it's really cool to see that. The Polish demos tend to have a particular style to them that
was not
I
this.
Like.
This didn't look Polish at all to me, in my humble opinion. You disagree clearly.
It looks kind of Polish to me. I'm fine with that.
This one is Polish as well. It's by Minim. It's called it's called Minim by Altair. I really like the cleanliness of
okay,
it all.
Okay, that is the strangest way of pronouncing Altair I have ever heard.
Altair?
Yeah, second. I
Altair.
Altair is speaking very funny.
Altairi.
Altair. No,
fine, Altair.
Yes.
Not only people from the United States said Altair.
You know, I've talked with the guys, and they've never corrected.
It's a Polish group, so
yes, they've never corrected me on my pronunciation of it when I've talked to them about it. You know, when they were a demo bit, or revision where I barely get to talk to anybody.
It might be Altair.
Actually, the thing is that, I mean, revision has become weird that I actually am talking to loads and loads of people, but
you're
not people at the party.
Yeah, you're like saying hello, hugging, and that's it.
Yeah, and I wouldn't really, you know, because of the feedback that we're getting from people that are actually saying, I came to this party for the first time, or I actually made a production, or that type of thing, I wouldn't change it. But it does just stress that I absolutely have to go to some other parties because otherwise I'm not going to get to see people, and that is not a good thing.
So when you were saying that they look Polish, this one looks polished. Is it the same thing?
No, this looks very polished.
Polished and Polish.
This actually reminds me a bit more of this is kind of a. And maybe it's because it's pink. But it reminds me a lot of Ninja Dev.
Hmm.
That is, and I like both of them. I really, this part, that part here with the
the ball going around.
Yeah, that reminds me of
that part. I like all parts.
I do. I like this demo. I actually haven't seen any of the stuff from Xenium. This is really good.
This is like really nice. It's like, Pierce, why aren't you full screening this?
That's why this show exists. Also, so you get to see the stuff.
Yeah. I'm going to have to. One of the other things is that I haven't had time to do Demo Ilta, and that obviously is a problem, because seeing these things, it's like, you know, this would also help me to de-stress, but I haven't had time to set it up properly. I should just get it to do it automatically, and then
yeah,
I
just do a script to do it all automatically.
No, I pretty much have it all. I have the thing that it generates the playlist and everything. I just have to actually download the data first. But I should do it so that it downloads the data at the beginning of the month.
Yeah, automate it.
We have it on a particular day, and then we just go there. And I'll share with you the playlist so you can have it. And I actually should. That's the other thing. I was actually going to put the playlist on the on a website, and actually have the thing where we could vote interactively or blah blah blah, because we had the thing. But it isn't actually holding me back. It's the not having the time. I shouldn't be stopping the Demo Ilta concept from happening because of not having a website that allows everybody. We should do it locally, and then yeah.
This is Quartz by Aberration Creations. It's PC64K. It won the PC64K comp. It's actually an 8K.
Okay, good, because I was thinking it's 64K. I hope for more content these days.
Yeah. I don't know why they didn't merge into a combined intro. It's one of the things that I don't really understand why other demo parties don't do it. Like, why don't they have, like, more combined compos? You see, like, compos from Cafe. They have, like, 20 compos with, like, 3 entries in each one. Why don't they just combine stuff? I make a more interesting compo overall. I don't know. It doesn't compute.
From Cafe?
For example, I mean, other parties, this one has the same problem. Nova had the same problem.
What am I missing? What, Cafe is...
Cafe is a Russian party that had a lot of categories.
Oh, Cafe party. Right, yeah. Right. I missed the... Yeah. Well, I think actually that it depends on what they want to do. I mean, some people actually don't want to compete in a combined compo because they feel that they will be...
Then they end up not competing because they're like two productions in the compo. Like, what kind of competition is that?
No, that's not what I'm seeing. Well, I'm seeing people not competing because they're like, no, I don't want to. The thing that I'm working on, if I get combined, I just won't be seen by anyone because I'm going to be up against things that are not even close to the platform that I'm working on. And how do you compare them? And then I'm just not going to have fair judging, so I'm just not going to enter. I see that from more people. So I completely understand having multiple things. I think in many cases, what parties will say is if they don't get 3 entries, they reserve the right to combine some compos.
Mm-hmm.
And that actually is the way to do it.
But when you combine compos, always ask the people who are in them.
Oh yeah. Yes,
yeah.
Because so don't throw together and don't tell, like, say, hey, truck, we are combining this together. Are you okay with that? And if they say no, I would like to pull my entry out. That's perfectly fine.
Yeah,
yeah.
Because there's always another party that they can enter into, and they might just release it at another party, even remote.
Yep.
I don't know. For Inertia this year, I decided to have one scene demo compo just to have more newbies doing stuff and have a combined a combined demo compo, and most people ended up participating on the one scene compo. And I was the only one who actually made a proper demo, and it had combined like everything in it. So like,
yeah, but I think that for one scene, there's like a lot of potential, and I said it's you know, oh, I have something, I don't have a demo, but now I will never release it, and that gives you an opportunity to, like, you know, put something out there, get some feedback, yeah. See your stuff on the big screen.
Yeah, I really like the concept of one scene. When I heard about it from Assembly and other parties that tried it out, I think it really made a lot of sense to get newbies involved, to get the old people to, you know, they don't have time, they have like 24 hours. I can just do one scene compo entry and that's it. I don't have to worry if it's 4K, 1K, it's a demo, whatever. It's, you know, it's fast made. It's whatever.
Or it doesn't have to be. There were some people that entered in the Assembly thing that actually spent a couple time, some time again.
Yeah, it's really good, but it's just one scene.
As a result, you had people who were competing at an even level, and not. It didn't make it. Oh, this is the baby combo, which is one thing I hated about the alt party thing the year that they did the.
Yeah, for newcomers only.
The newcomer combo.
That feels
that
a bit forced.
So fucking much.
And then it's hard to define what is new, what is not new. I mean, you can know about the demo scene, but never have made a production. Or you can be like a very talented graphics programmer and just doing his first entry, so it's not very fair.
Then the whole thing of, oh, you're not good enough to compete with the other people. Bullshit. Which that year the. I mean, that just basically just got straight put in there because the winner of the actual demo compo had never competed in any compos before, and they just decided they were going to compete in the demo compo rather than the
newbie compo.
The newbie compo, yeah. And they won. It was a great demo. They even it was Binary Babble, they even got nominated, I think, for a Scene.org award. I don't think it was Meteorix at that point.
This is a 4K. It won the Compo X Xenium. Pretty darn good.
It has one of those atmospheres that's not that easy to create.
Even
in a demo, that you have to work really hard to get this atmosphere together, and sometimes it just works and sometimes it never does.
It's made by KK, Virgil, and Lesnik. So pretty good stuff.
KK tends to know what he's doing as far as 4Ks. Virgil tends to know what he's doing as far as 4Ks. And Lesnik tends to have a sense of style.
I really like how much talent the 4K category has been bringing out on these last couple of years. Like, we've seen Nobi, Virgil, Slurpee, LJ, so many people coming out, like, just doing a lot of quality 4Ks. I think it's really amazing, and it's I think it's one of the categories that it's, like, more interesting to follow in the demo scene. That will be more interesting to follow in 2020. Like, the 4K compo at Revision is gonna be mind-blowing for sure.
Maybe. The thing is that you never know for sure. I mean, we have these things where
at Revision you have the 8K as well, so we might have a killer 8K.
See, that's the thing is, it might be this might be the year for 8K rather than 4K.
Yeah, I can see that. I can see that people might do 8K.
And maybe it's
going to
be the thing for 64K again.
That I'm not so convinced. Anyways, moving out of Xenium, we move into the function party, which also took place in September. I'm gonna load up the results so I know what I'm talking about exactly. There were two entries by this guy that tends to do these kind of demos.
His name is Sly Spy, dude.
That.
Rainbows, clouds, unicorns.
He did two demos. One called Rainbow Clash Down.
This is one of those cases where you just have some. This guy, Sly Spy, has a particular style.
Yes.
You can pretty much tell. Yes, this is a Sly Spy demo.
He did two demos from him at the compo. One called Down, the other one called Up. We're watching Down at the moment. No, we're actually watching Up. We're watching Up.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's an interesting thing. So the Down one is the upbeat one, and the Up one is the.
Nothing is what you think it is. Everything you know is wrong.
They just do it to confuse us.
Gonna have to ask. So, P.S. Did you do the music for Up then?
One thing interesting about I watched this live streamed on my sofa, and it was interesting because the demo crashed twice at exactly the same point, and they retried it one third time. Apparently, there was this 50% probability of it crashing at that particular point, which was weird in itself. And it actually went through when everyone was cheering that the demo played through instead of crashing. That was an amazing moment. We were like, why are you playing it again? It's just going to crash again at that point. Oh my god, that's so stupid. And then it worked. And we're like, hey!
If you've been to a Hungarian party, you know that's the way that it goes.
It's a weird bug, though. It only crashes 15% of the time. Like, how fucked up is your the stuff need to be on your code base to do that? Like, it can't be a missing asset. It needs to be something with the RAM.
No. It's like, okay, so will one thread outrace the other? If it does, sorry.
Yeah,
that's probably exactly what it is. It's probably race condition.
Yeah.
Also, reality joined.
He was at the tap bar earlier. He posted on Twitch like, oh, I'm at the tap bar and this is playing. I told him to drink a stout for me. A Russian Imperial stout, probably. Or hopefully. That's what I would pick. So this is Down. By the same guy, Sly Spy. I really love his stuff. I love his style.
Yeah, it's
the music is way more Belgian already. It's like you only need one bar and one finger to play this.
Sly Spy does have a particular style, but there are so many facets to it.
Yeah. It's not repetitive.
No, and he does explore different. Many different things when he's doing things.
Frank is asking how many entries were at this compo. There were 7 entries at the PC demo compo at Function. This particular demo got 4th place. Up, the one that we watched before, got 2nd place. And the winner is the one that we're gonna play after this one. I think it's 7. It might mean that people didn't upload. Let me double check the results file.
Is the winner the one?
Yes, it is. That,
okay.
Powell Driver by Gargai.
Right, yeah.
The one with the info file more interesting than the demo. But people still like the demo.
Well, I wrote. We had this discussion at one point on the Telegram chat, and I wrote some things about it on Mastodon. So. I'll wait till that is playing.
This one needs to be added to my rave entry playlist of demos.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
If there's one thing I would say about it, as far as the Belgian part, though, it's missing bass.
It's missing bass. How low can you go? Add more bass.
Oh, well, no. With the C64, sub-bass very low. I've been to well airball gigs where the entire structure went into resonation mode because it hit the resonance frequency of the concrete. That was awesome. So, and now it's the info file?
No, oh, yeah. Pile driver. So apparently this is a demo to beat all cliches, like go to every single cliche that makes a demo great. And Gargai was having a hard time making it because he felt that it was just uninspired and boring and stupid that he was spending so much time doing it. But he wanted to prove a point that he could make the best cliche demo ever. But if you read the info file, it's quite depressive. And it makes you think about what kind of demos you should be making.
No, it doesn't. He completely missed the point, again, of...
They missed his own point?
No. There was a demo by Kuehler's. It was called Veriform 2. And
the best demo ever.
It was...
No, the second best demo ever.
It was a statement that, okay, look, you asked us to make this demo. Here you go. You asked for it. Here you can have it.
I think Gargai's statement was not about him in particular.
Many years of Curly making other groups and doing things just to get away from having to make now later
keep
on,
up with expectations.
Later on, there was a production that Conspiracy did that stated. In the info file, Kuehler's, this is how you make a sequel. And all they did with that thing was added a voice sample. And it's just like, it was decent until I read that, and it was just like, oh, you just don't get it. This demo, and Gargai's fighting over, hey, why should I make this demo? I don't want to. He completely missed the whole point. And I don't know how many times he's going to go through this until he figures out. Don't make demos you don't want to. Make demos for yourself, not for the audience. If nobody else likes it, it doesn't matter.
I think his point from the info file was that people like this kind of stuff instead of liking the more experimental stuff. Like, people fall for this kind of, like, you put vocals in a demo, people will like it. You put fast-paced music, people will like it.
People will always go towards the popular.
Yeah.
And you don't have to make a demo to appease everybody. You don't.
If you complain about that, yeah, you're in the wrong thing, you know. Never make demos for others. Make them for yourself.
Yeah. I mean, he totally. I mean, the whole soundtrack thing right there. That whole. Oh, we're gonna do the gloom thing where you have this thing and then you have the break and you put the bad rap after it. Yes, he's not making his own demo.
He's doing excess
demo for somebody else. He didn't have to do it. And if he didn't want to do it, why did he?
And if you do it as a parody. This is not a parody.
No. He should have totally
he did a parody at some point, but it was so minimalistic that people didn't understand it was a parody. So that's why he made this one. This is like the next version of the parody.
This is really bad anger management, and I'm sorry, Gargai, but this is bad anger.
It is. I agree. Gargai has much more talent than making demos that for other people. He should make demos that he wants to make, period. Why are ASD demos when they go out on a limb and do experimental stuff better than the ones when they just try to win assembly? For the same reason. And Gargai didn't have to win function. I mean, sure, some people would say, oh, You didn't. We didn't have a demo from Conspiracy or from Gargi that just won the compo and blew us all away. That's not the point. Again, make demos, and when you have something that doesn't blow you all away, look at the other ones and see what was good about them. It's very rare that you're going to have a demo compo at a party where everything is bad. Even in 2004, with Winter Demo winning, there were two other demos in that compo that were good, even though there were 24, and it was the longest demo compo ever. And the other two were the invite that Melwyn did with the flower things and the X-Mix thing. Those are the ones. Oh, and Panjab Moor.
Winter demo?
Was Panjab Moor, obviously winter demo is a good thing, but was Panjab Moor also from 2004 or was that from 2003?
No, I'm not sure.
Well, Google tell you.
Yes, it will. We'll go check now.
Panjab Moor is from 2004.
Okay, so that is another one of the productions out of that extremely long combo block. So yeah, even when you have something that's really, really long and there aren't that many great things, they're generally, you have to just go back and look.
There are a few things that I want to add, but first I want to mention that this is second place from the 4K combo. What I wanted to add to what you said about the Gargi stuff is that I think this demo in particular was a follow-up to a demo that he made making fun of those industrial big beat kind of stuff that went a bit unnoticed or got bad feedback that it wasn't trying hard enough. So he wanted to do a version that he actually tried hard enough to come across to the point that this just feels like it's a cliche mash of uninspired stuff. But I agree with you that it's a bit of bad anger management, in my humble opinion. But I have to play the devil's advocate here. I really liked the demo, despite it being cliche. I wouldn't, like, play it over and over again. But I liked that it was, you know, somewhat polished and in your face in terms of sound attitude. So I liked that part of it. Anyways, this is XPYW, or some Cyrillic values that kind of look like XPYW because apparently the system that they use to input entries doesn't handle Cyrillic very well yet. And we don't have a video of actually the winner from Function. It's not on YouTube.
I thought you said that Gargi's won.
No, the 4K.
Oh, the 4K, right.
This is a 64-byte entry called Into War. It didn't win the compo, but it's fucking darn good. It has the chopper sound! It's 64 bytes!
Oh, I actually missed that. I was wondering what was going to happen.
That's just it. It has nothing else. Just 64 bytes. Right.
Well, again, like you said, or like I said earlier, sometimes when you put all the stuff into the audio, then you miss the whole demo is more audio.
Well, it's a view of the jungle in 64 bytes. There's nothing else to show.
Well, it's not the jungle.
It's a minimalistic version of the jungle.
Yeah, but now I want to see a chopper.
Get to the chopper!
I have trouble calling this the jungle because the jungle has trees. You said you're not the best demo singer?
Well, okay, now we have a tutorial on how to become a demo singer. Step number one, get inspired. Could this maybe be the tutorial that Gargi followed for Pile Driver?
That's what I'm thinking. Gargi probably should have followed this.
Well, you know, yeah, but see, like, this is a parody. Number two.
Yes.
So was Pile Driver, so...
No.
It wasn't.
Yeah. Step number three. make the tune. For a kick-ass tune, you need only the basics. And a few effects.
That's worth perfect.
We know that sample.
Make the graphics.
God damn it! Mm.
Yeah. Step number 5. Nourishment. It is very important to have the energy to make a proper demo. Remember, a healthy meal keeps the scene going.
Nourishment is important.
I don't understand. There hasn't been any beer so far.
I recommend using SMB. And also, why is your liquid called jar while it's in a bottle?
I think it's actually cleaning fluid.
It is.
Yeah.
Step number 7. Bathe in your own excellence.
Yeah. That's always important.
Step number 8. Moral support. Ask your friends for their honest and supportive opinion.
Oh god, it was bad.
I mean, holy shit!
This is horrible.
What the fuck was that shit?
It's really bad. It's terrible.
What the fucking crap.
Damn, this was really bad.
Holy shit, what the fuck was that?
What the hell was that?
What the fuck?
It was crap.
That was the worst thing I ever saw!
Such monkey balls, bro.
What the fuck was that shit?
Oh my god, that was horrible, man.
It was a piece of shit.
Oh my fucking gosh.
It was shit.
It was beyond shit.
Beyond
shit.
Step number 9. Take your release to a party.
Yeah, release it anyways.
Hey everyone! I made a demo!
You're a fucking loser!
Yep, sounds legit.
That's totally how that works.
Anyways, that was Function. Let's move on to Flash Party in South America, because they do have parties there. Argentina. This was a remake of the Another World intro for the Commodore 64, I believe. And I guess this is a video player, so you can rant about Bad Apple.
Yeah, I'm looking at it.
It's an easy flash release, so yes, it's very likely it's a video player.
Yeah.
Maybe they have a part where you can actually play.
Okay, I'll give them props for not using for not using Bad Apple, but I'm gonna have to take that point away for using a classic such as this. I mean, when Bob did the tribute to this, it was his own content. Bob Ape on Beep.
Bob, we need more.
Okay, can we skip to the next one now? We know what this is.
Okay, so I'm gonna go to a Pickaway demo instead.
That's better.
The Pickaway demo won the low-end intro combo. It's called Splush by Proxima.
Oh, look, Truck, it's a science crawler. They will never make anything better. You might as well sell it.
Yep.
That's why I don't do stuff for the Pico 8. I can't beat a side scroller.
Sign scroller.
Yeah, man. You can't even open the borders like Total Loser.
I remember on NTSC we didn't see that because nobody did actual
things.
I mean, stable rasters. I didn't see them until I got to Europe. all of the FBR intros have unstable rasters. It's just, it's, yeah.
Now look what that got us.
This is quite impressive, actually, the effects. I rather like them.
I wanted to show more stuff from Flash Party, but unfortunately, well, they do have a winner of the combined demo intro that I would like to show, but it doesn't have a YouTube video, so I can't play it, which sucks, because it's actually quite decent looking. It's called Up and Down by Pungas de Villa Martelli. Should have recorded this. It was announced so shortly, I didn't have time to record any stuff missing.
How do you pronounce PNM again?
Pungas de Villa Martelli.
Yeah, that's what he said.
PVM. Pungas de Villa Martelli. Tío, coño, ¿dónde está la zapatería? So, okay, we're gonna do a deadline, and then we're gonna call it a day. Sounds good?
Okay, does that mean we're gonna do Zoo also in next month?
Yes.
Okay, all right, not next month, next week. Okay.
Yes, next week, exactly. So we're gonna take a look at a MySQL demo because we can do demos in MySQL, apparently. If I can manage to find the proper, yeah, let's find this. Okay, there we go.
So, wide combo. First entry is by Nick, Old Seatsu, and MySQL.
I hear a Bombay.
Yes.
Bombay, you're live.
Okay, so
we can still hear your magnetic thingy truck, by the way.
Yes, I know. I have trouble not.
He has stopped caring.
What we're showing here is the entry called MySQL Ray Tracer.
It's usually when you're doing compos for like, yes, I made this thing and I want to get a microphone, you get really scared.
Which takes quite a while to compute.
But at least this guy has, you know, something to tell.
Didn't we have a couple dozen things that evoke this year that were the same way?
Yes, and yet, like, no idea what the fuck they were talking about. I'm sorry, but that was completely lost to us.
We actually were talking about making a parody of that for next year.
Just an SQL statement that...
Well, thank you for ruining the surprise.
Well... I think if we mention it now, that maybe we'll get over the people being angsty about it.
Are you talking about the German thing? People not knowing how to present their own games?
Yes.
Okay. That sounds good. I want to see that. But you already explained me, so I'm not going to be angry about it. You might want to talk to the Germans about that as well. Explain all the technical details and fail to explain what you're actually showing.
This is what you're gonna get if you have the time.
I am showing now the bunny. It is made out of triangles.
The bunny is low poly. A low poly is made by several small dots in the world connected by a surface.
And then you have a triangle. A triangle is made out of three points, which when put together create the bunny or multiple other things.
Also, Bomba, this is the part where I would prefer if that would have actually had a scroller explaining it rather than him talking.
Anyways, moving on to the 4K compos, we had this by LJ and Virtual.
The obligatory multiplayer game that in the Wi-Fi dies immediately.
Yeah, it never works. I don't know how people failed to test that. Anyways, I want to talk about this because I really like this 4K. So I want you guys to talk about this one.
This is a 4K.
It has lines in green and white.
I would like to listen to it because I really like the soundtrack.
It's by Virtual.
I can't remember what...
Yes.
There's a song that also has a very similar thing that I can't remember at the moment. Is this the one on the 8-bit?
What do you mean, 8-bit?
Well, that previous scene looked a lot like another one that we saw earlier on an 8-bit Atari. But obviously no, because this cannot be done on an 8-bit Atari.
Nope. This is by LJ in Virtual, not by KK. If it was by KK, I would give you that, because the KK does both 4K stuff on PC, and he also does Atari stuff, which I find amazing and awesome.
Yeah, the soundtrack for this is really, really good.
I really like how everything is like 2D mostly.
Yes. And lots of kaleidoscope effects.
Yeah. Everything's fractals, man. Everything's fractals.
Everything's a fractal when you're brave enough. It's okay.
So yeah, that won the combined intro compo at Deadline. Introspection by LJ and Virtual. And what else do we have lined up here? We have Essence, a 64-byte intro, which won the combined 256-byte intro compo. It's pretty much this. It's pretty good for 64 bytes, though, as sound and 3D.
Yes. Although, I'm a bit disappointed that the one cube is, you know, we don't see the top of it, so I kind of think that it was an optimization to get it smaller, and it just kind of looks like an optimization to get it smaller.
And has motion blur.
Yes. Yes. And an XOR Which texture. Is-
Nice. And the last entry that I wanted to show about Deadline, there was an interesting entry by Still, but it's way too long and way too repetitive. And it was... Okay, I'm gonna show it anyways. I don't care. I don't care. It's my show. I can do whatever I please. I'm going to show it.
This is Hold On, not Still.
Yeah, that's because I'm not playing what I was saying that I was going to play. Now I changed. Because I was thinking of skipping this one. Because this one came out.
I like it already.
It's a bit repetitive. It's good, but it's just a bit repetitive.
I'm
and
not
he has
have a problem with this
as this text things. The one thing that I want to mention, though, is that there was this special version made by Laz with text taken from the info file of Piledriver, which I recommend everyone to watch.
Okay, I'm going to have to see yes. that one then.
That's the really good play, version.
Why don't we play that one?
Yes. Because it's not on YouTube, I think.
Come on.
You know what we should... Would you be able to show these things off of if you had a capture card?
I will need another computer, I think.
Okay, so you only have the one computer.
Well, I mean, I have a laptop, but I don't think I can put four screens on it.
Your Windows computer with... And then, yeah, and yeah, you'd need another computer because this capture card that I have is a ISIM card.
I mean, I think I should get an Elgato and try to do stuff out of that... But I would need to be streaming from the laptop if that was the case, I think.
Well, I have a Blackmagic PCI. It's either PCI or PCIe capture card. But
And my problem with using the laptop is that I can't have like four screens on the laptop. I can only have one extra screen, which is kind of shitty to manage all the stuff that's happening at the same time. So I would end up having a high-end machine just to play a demo and occasionally crash. Which kind of sucks. So I should get another machine. That's pretty much the bottom line. A dedicated machine for the streaming part. But, you know, it costs money and I haven't gotten around to it yet. Eventually, when this one starts becoming too old, I will get another one. So maybe for season 5, who knows? Anyways, this was made by Still, and they did a live set as well at Deadline, and it was sort of taken an effect from the live set and just made a demo out of it. But still looks pretty good. And has a political message. So none of you guys went to Deadline, right?
No, I had work.
Okay, that's unfortunate.
Let's see, wasn't Deadline also like a week?
First week of October, I believe.
Right, so
or,
it was the same time as
last
Inertia.
Of September, I think.
No, Inertia was the first week of November. What was going on? Something was going on then.
It was in October. I just don't know the exact dates, but it was in October.
You know, we're all what we're also missing. We're missing the productions from Umalauta.
Sausage Fest.
No, not Umalauta Sausage Fest.
Yeah, this is.
I'm gonna leave Cafe Intersac and that kind of stuff and zoo stuff for next week's show.
Yeah.
So we're gonna play this and we're gonna play what for me is the best demo of 2019 so far, which is Nostrum by Olon. And we're gonna wrap up the show on that. So I guess I'm gonna take this opportunity to thank everyone for showing up already, and then we can just talk whatever we want about Nostrum and wrap it up. So thank you, Frankie and Chuck, for returning to the show on such short notice. Thank you also for the Patreon supporters, Garfield, Jeff Thornton, Paul Jean Poptipt, El Topo, Fulcrum, Paul Falcon, Get It Westendorf, Evil, Gaspod, Branch, and VZ. This was really hard to read with all these white lines on the background, so props to me for managing to put that up. We will have another show next week, 18th of December, same hour, with the rest of the demos from this month of October, the demos from November and December. So yeah, we're gonna cover Zoo then. So yeah, thank you everyone also in the chat who showed up. Thanks so much for your support.
See you next week.
We still have one more demo to show, so talk cool. Something.
So certainly now there's time not to rush.
Yeah. This demo is quite long, actually. It's like 6 minutes and a half.
Yes, it is. It's very long.
But that line felt like it had the same, not problem, but I don't know what other word to use. Like, there are too many parties and not enough people doing releases for them. You see the same people struggling to find the time to be at all the parties and release everything.
It's like going to a party like Deadline. I would, if I go to Deadline, which I really should do once, is to combine it with a week in the city.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So
yeah, Berlin is really cool.
So you have to like arrive on Tuesday, Wednesday, take 2-3 days, go and see the city, then go to the party and go home.
I had the best experience in assembly, but yeah.
I just remembered something somebody said in the car at Evoke about Inertia.
It's the best of a party ever. You should stay there for one whole week.
No, I just remembered something.
What else do I want to say? Berlin was really good. I really liked the Brewdog brewery there. And apparently they have a new one, bigger one. So I definitely want to visit it again. They had Tokyo on tap. That's like the best beer they have. And they had it on tap. It was so good.
That could be very dangerous. I still have a bottle of Tokyo. Tokyo Horizon in the fridge because
you're waiting for a golden opportunity to open it and notice that it's gone bad.
Why would it go bad?
Because those that are stronger usually last for longer. That's true, but beer can go bad.
Like, no, real beer stops improving.
I'm like, well, this isn't a lager.
Real beer. Anyways, Nostromo by Holland. I think it's the best demo so far in 2019. I really like the whole mood of it, the effects. It's very minimalistic, cohesive. I really enjoyed it a lot. Do you guys have anything to add to the demo that we're currently watching?
I have not seen this demo
yet. Okay, fair enough.
So I'll have to actually watch this on my new PC that is actually capable of playing these demos. I had not gotten a new PC since 2010. Well, I'd not gotten a new demo PC. I had several laptops for doing work and so on. But...
not with a decent graphics card.
You know, halfway decent graphics card, but you know, the most of your demos, they will run at a lower frame rate, or you know, you have to hook up an external monitor that's smaller in order to get it to actually look decent, because it probably won't fit on the laptop screen because it's not made for that resolution, etc., etc., etc.
Yeah. The problems of having laptops.
And the, you know, the ones that had NVIDIA cards tended to be, you know, a couple years older NVIDIA card. Or, I mean, I have one laptop that I got from work that has had a really good NVIDIA card from that period of time. It's still a good NVIDIA card, but that machine tends to overheat when I'm trying to do things, because it just suffers from having ventilation issues on the bottom. So I have to run I have to have one of those laptop cooler pads underneath it. And I tend to use it for work anyway, because I have four monitors hooked up to it, so.
It's actually a WebGL demo. It was made with cables GL technology that Pandur been developing. It has a whole graphical interface thing. If you guys don't know it and you're looking for a demo tool, I recommend you check it out, cables.gl. Oh yeah, we'll love that one. So yeah, that's it. Thank you guys for watching. See you next week. Bye-bye, everyone. Take care.
See you soon.
Yep, catch you.